So, ladies and gentlemen, the last part is, how did we get to this situation where we've got record high coral cover, despite the fact we've had four massive bleaching events which supposedly killed a huge amount of coral? Clearly there is a problem with the quality assurance of the science, that things are getting wrong in the scientific institutions. Now, one of the unfortunate things is that it's much bigger than just the Great Barrier Reef. So there is a problem with the Great Barrier Reef scientific institutions, but it's actually much broader than that. Now, they call it the replication crisis. So what we've got is that it turns out that about 50% of the recent scientific literature has got problems with it. Now, let's be clear. I'm not talking about your textbook, your physics or chemistry textbook, right? Those are just about rock solid. Just about everything in there is completely shpicko, okay? I'm talking about the recent stuff that's coming out from some of the institutions, especially if there's a little bit of ideology and if it hasn't been properly tested. Now, I actually have a picture of a dementor which is a bit washed out there. And the reason I have that is that whereas that I don't think that there's any problem with the reef and that a lot of the scientific institutions go on doom, doom, doom like a dementor, this really is a problem and we really do need to worry about this. So the replication crisis, you can Google it and you'll get thousands of hits. So whereas my views on the reef are a minority, there's a big minority that think like me, but it is a minority. And the major institutions would oppose what I'm saying. They rarely argue, but they oppose it. On the replication crisis, just about everybody agrees. In science, we have a problem. And I'm going to show you that. So, for example, this paper which came out just a few years ago, and there's literally hundreds and hundreds of new papers coming out on this, 1,500 scientists lift the lid on reproducibility. What do we mean by reproducibility? Well, if I as a scientist do some work, I publish a paper, and it then what should happen is that another scientist should be able to do more or less the same thing, same experiment or whatever, and get more or less the same result. They should be able to reproduce it. But it turns out that only about half the time is that original work reproducible. That's terrible. That's actually a scandal that half of this work is wrong. And so, for example, even with the Great Barrier Reef stuff, there's been some recent very controversial stuff come out where, for example, at a northern university that works on the Great Barrier Reef, these two guys here and some other people did replication studies on a whole lot of stuff on the effect of carbon dioxide on reef fish, which supposedly said that the reef fish were doomed. It found it all wrong. The whole thing was wrong. Multiple papers were found to be inaccurate. And even on occasion, some of this stuff is coming out that is almost even fraudulent. Though most of the stuff that we're talking about, you know, 99% is not fraudulent, it's just wrong. Nobody's done anything necessarily bad, they just got it wrong for whatever reason. And you've got to ask, well, why did they get this wrong? Why is 50% so bad? Because I could ask you the question, can you think of another profession, and this is me talking as a scientist, right, all my life, can you think of a profession that is as untrustworthy as a scientist? 50% is wrong, right? We're almost unique, and that is a scandal. And the reason is that we fail on our quality assurance. So what is our quality assurance to make sure that what we're doing is right? We have this system called peer review. Has anybody heard of peer review? Right, you've heard of it. Could you tell me what peer review is?
Peer review is when you pass it on to a colleague or someone else to check your work. Say in English, if you wrote a page, you'd edit it, and then you'd pass it on to someone else to edit it, and then someone else to edit it.
Yeah, that's right. So it goes to other scientists. Now, most the institutions will often say peer review is the gold standard, right? And most people think that peer review is when it goes to other workers and they redo the experiments, they, you know, redo the calculation. It might be a dozen other peers who might look at it for months and really check to make sure it's right. That's what you'd sort of expect, but it's not. Normally what happens with peer review is that it gets given to maybe two other scientists who are in the field and they look at it for maybe a couple of hours. That's it. It may be a day at the most, generally speaking not. I've done hundreds and hundreds of peer reviews, and that's basically what it is, right? This is our main quality assurance system. So it is so cursory and so slight that it's not surprising that a lot of wrong work actually gets through. So this is what this guy has said about. This is a very prestigious fellow, right? He's editor of one of the most prestigious medical journals in the world, The Lancet, Richard Horton. He said, "We know that the system of peer review is biased, unjust, unaccountable, incomplete, easily fixed, often insulting, usually ignorant, occasionally foolish, and frequently wrong. This is our main quality assurance system in science, right? Certainly the main primary one. Is it any wonder when it's all of these things that 50% is wrong? It's a scandal. And as a scientist, I find it acutely embarrassing." The other thing is that it almost guarantees groupthink, right? Because you're circulating amongst your peers. You give your peers your work essentially to review. Now, what's going to happen there is groupthink is almost inevitable, because if you're a dissenter, right, I don't think that is correct. Now you can't get your work published because you want to publish a different evidence that says something different. The peers don't like that for whatever reason, and now you can no longer be published. So it excludes. And there's been, whole books written on the problems of groupthink in science. And groupthink is very, very bad because you want a debate, you want an argument. If you look at all the major, big scientists of their time, they were all dissenters to start with. Einstein and Newton and Darwin, they were all dissenters, right? And you cannot afford groupthink to form in science. But peer review almost guarantees that it's going to form. We have this fellow here, John Ioannidis from Stanford University, a mathematician, works in the biomedical area. And he's sort of like the father of the replication crisis, in the sense that he blew the whistle on it about 15 years ago. And he published this amazing paper demonstrating why most published research findings are false, at least in the biomedical area. Now, can you imagine that? Nobody's disagreeing with this paper, by the way. That everybody agrees that he's right, that in the biomedical area, most of the public, research findings have serious problems. It's an absolute scandal what's going on here, right? So, and then you look at, there was a big article in The Economist a few years ago. This actually sent me literally into a depression about science, because I suddenly realized that as a profession, my profession was untrustworthy and unreliable. It was a study that looked at when drug companies who want to take, say, a promising university research finding that demonstrates that a particular chemical cures cancer, right? The first thing they will usually do is try to replicate that original work. They will usually do it, not always, they should. And they find that when they did that, about 80% of the original work was wrong, right? 80%. And this is by prestigious scientists, prestigious universities. It's not just, some Tom, Dick and Harry here. And that's a scandal too. So coming back to Richard Horton, he's got a bit of a way with words, and this is a very famous quote of his that other people have used too. He said, "The case against science is straightforward. Much of the scientific literature, perhaps half, may simply be untrue. Afflicted by studies with small sample sizes, tiny effects, invalid exploratory analysis, and flagrant conflicts of interest, together with an obsession for pursuing fashionable trends of dubious importance, science has taken a turn towards darkness." Now, let's get this right. Science is wonderful. Science has propelled us out of the dark ages to what we have now. So I'm not anti-science, but what is happening at the moment is really seriously concerning. Because we've got to the situation where a lot of the institutions are not as trustworthy as we'd like them to be. Nevertheless, people still do, by and large, trust the institutions, and you can on most things. You can trust the engineering institutions to build a bridge that will not fall down. We can trust Boeing most of the time to build an aircraft that will not crash. But when it comes to some of these other things with a degree of ideology, there is a problem. Now, we all want to trust the institutions. There's something about us that we want to believe in them, and why not? They've done so much for us. But we have a problem, you see, because if I give a talk to somebody and I say, we're at record high coral cover, and it's not just me saying, that's not me saying it, that's what the Australian Institute of Marine Science data shows. If we're at record high coral cover and we've had four bleaching events in the last 6 years which killed 93% of the coral, which can't be true, both of these things can't be true at the same time, then the corollary of the reef being in wonderful condition is that we've been told untruths. I won't say lies, because in many cases they're not deliberately lying, but certainly we're talking about things which are untrue. Which means that some wonderful institutions have been untrustworthy to us. They've let us down, and other institutions who've reported on this and will not report on the dissenters have let us down. And this is a horrible, horrible thought for most people, including myself, right? That these institutions have let us down. But you know, getting this wrong, it has consequences. You know, you might think, well, does it matter that we all believe that the reef is dying? Well, it does, you know, because there's a whole bunch, there's a whole generation of children and teenage, and even people as old as my daughter, who's almost 30, right? There are a lot of them in great depression about this. But we then have things like legislation in Queensland, which is really damaging the farming community. They're being blamed for killing the reef, and they're being told to restrict all sorts of things that they do. It's restricting every major industry in North Queensland. And there are other examples of where this bad science is reaching through and actually affecting real people in a real way. So in Canada, they're restricting fertilizer usage. They're going to reduce it by up to 30%. Well, what's going to happen? There's going to be a reduction in the amount of food that Canada produces. They export a huge amount of their food. It's also based on some highly dubious science. I won't go into the details. The same thing is happening in the Netherlands, where they're restricting agriculture based on some dubious science. So this does affect us in many ways. But there are then other sort of perverse ways where it affects us, because if you're worried about the Great Barrier Reef and you're spending all this worry, this money worrying about the Great Barrier Reef and to save it when it doesn't really need to be saved, it means there's a whole lot of other things which you should be doing which you're not doing, because we've only got a certain capacity. So I worry about natural climatic variations, right? Not by carbon dioxide. I think that's a low risk, but I do worry about the large-scale volcanic eruptions that occur every 200 years or so, which cause a sharp change of a degree or so, and that is much more damaging than a 1 degree change over 100 years. And we know these occur because they've occurred in history. We can see 1815, I forget the other dates, right? You go back in time. We need to worry about our energy reliability, which we're not. But even in Australia, environmental problems. Almost nobody in the cities knows about the problems of feral animals or noxious weeds, and yet there are a terrible environmental problem out there in the rangelands. Or, in my view, the problems of population growth, the expansion of the cities into the farmland. This is changing the environment in a major way. We don't worry about those things because we're worried about the climate change and we're worried about the Great Barrier Reef. Now, we've got to make sure that we get our priorities right. There are always threats, and you've got to prioritise on the big threats that are really going to knock you over rather than the ones that aren't. So what I've been proposing is that what we've got to do is we need an audit of Great Barrier Reef science, right? A lot of it will be right. Some of what I'm saying may well not be right, right? I may well have some of the stuff wrong, but that's always the case. The only way you get to the truth, or closer to the truth, is by having an argument. And what we need to do is we need to audit a lot of this reef science. It would only cost a few million dollars, right, to do that. We're spending billions of dollars on the reef, so why would you not? Who would argue against spending a little bit more money checking that reef science? Guess who would argue against it? Who does argue against it? The institutions, which I'm saying have got it wrong, and who have now demonstrated to be wrong, all right? For some reason, they argue against checking of their work. That's got to tell you something. But anyway, what I say to you people is, you know, ring the church bells. We're in a convent, so this is really good that we could ring the church bells. Take a day off school on Monday, celebrate, because the reef is in absolutely wonderful condition. We're at record high coral cover. go back to your school and tell all your friends, because it really is wonderful news and we should all be rejoicing on that. Thanks very much.
Do you know of any large institutions that would actually be trustworthy that don't just completely conform to the narrative which we can actually trust?
I think if you're in the hard sciences, almost all of them are completely trustworthy, where there's no ideology, there's no politics, there's not much of a funding distortion. So if you look about at organisations like CERN, the big physics mob, you know, they're just doing normal physics. If you look at the big engineering research institutions, totally trustworthy. I mentioned Boeing, totally trustworthy, even though they've had a couple of little crashes recently. You know, where it's very clear where their failure is, like with a plane crashing or a bridge crashing, they are trustworthy, right? It's where there's ideology where the doom won't happen for another 100 years, right? So they can keep on getting it wrong for 100 years. The proof of the pudding, which is the, you know, the final result, is such a long way away. That's where we have problems with trustworthy. So we have still huge numbers of institutions in the hard sciences which are completely reliable, which is at least good news.
If there are so many scientists studying the reef, why are there so many different responses on what's happening?
Well, there's actually not so many responses. There's sort of like the consensus group, and it's very dangerous to step outside that consensus group. If you do, bad things can happen to your career, okay? And that's actually the problem, that there's not enough views. That I know plenty of scientists who are young in their career who wouldn't necessarily agree with everything that I'm saying, but would agree with the broad thing. And they know they have to be relatively quiet on that. So the problem is the opposite. There's not enough views on the reef that are getting out there. Was that your question? It was, yeah. Yeah.
What do you think Australia's coastline would look like if the Great Barrier Reef didn't exist?
It would look pretty much the same. Remember, these are these flat-topped hills. So if all the coral died, the flat-top hill will remain. It will remain there for a few million years until it eventually erodes away, and then the coastline would erode back because all the big waves would reach the coast. But of course, in a million years, the sea level would have gone up and down by 100 metres about six times in that time. So there's massive upheavals happening on Earth. People often think the Earth remains, you know, more or less the same, but actually on geological time, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions of years, there are these enormous changes which occur. And in fact, we must think of the Earth as a constantly changing system, both biologically and geologically, not as it remains exactly the same all the time. So I sort of half answered the question. It basically will stay the same, yeah. They're an incredible changes. You know that river that I, see this river here? This is a big river. That's the river at the mouth is over a kilometre across, right? So about here, it's about a kilometre across. Biggest river in North Queensland. If you go back just a couple of thousand years, the river mouth was over here. Now, a couple of thousand years sounds a long time ago, but it's not that long, you know. Jesus Christ, 2,000 years ago, 4,000 years ago, 5,000 years ago, you're talking about Egyptians building pyramids. The river was over here. It changes by, that river has changed course roughly every 1,000 years, and this is a serious river. That Yarra River is just a tiny little river compared with the Burdekin River, right? And it changes every 1,000 years by many kilometres. So we live on an Earth that changes all the time. And that's something which we've got to remember with the climate change debate. Climate changes rapidly. Go back 5,000 years when they were building pyramids. The Earth was 1 to 2 degrees hotter than it is today. They call it the Holocene climatic optimum. It was hotter than it is today, quite naturally, right? So changing Earth, things change.
How much of a danger do you think oil spills are to reefs and just the climate in general?
Oil spills are certainly a local problem. I mean, the big one, the last really huge one, the Exxon Valdez one, or even the one in the Gulf of Mexico, they were a local problem. For reefs themselves, the Great Barrier Reef, it's not really a problem because there's no oil exploration there. Actually, reefs are relatively unaffected because the oil spill affects just the, you know, sticks to the surface, and most of the coral is well below the water level. It would certainly wipe out coral that comes up to the surface. and you know it would be wiped out for a decade or two, but it would come back. But if you go to the Persian Gulf, where there's oil spills more or less quite regularly, because there's a huge amount of oil there, there's still corals, plenty of corals, even in the Persian Gulf. And by the way, the water there is probably 5 or 6 degrees hotter than it is on the Great Barrier Reef, and they still have good corals there. Nowhere near as good as the Great Barrier Reef, but that's for other reasons, not because of the heat or the oil. You know, the Great Barrier Reef is a big marine park, and one of the reasons that it was listed, this is in the 1970s, and in fact my mother was involved with one of the organisations that was originally involved with the listing of it as a national park, was that they were going to drill oil on the Great Barrier Reef, right? This is in the 1960s. And people thought, you've got to be joking, we're not going to allow this. And quite rightly, you don't want that sort of thing happening right next to the Great Barrier Reef. So it's not going to happen on the reef. They're very careful with the shipping that goes up and down the reef. So they try to, not just any ship can go up there, you need to have a special pilot on board every ship. So they are very, very careful with shipping on the reef.
Do you think today was an important project?
I did think it was important. I think that kids get very mixed messages in school, and I think the message that it's not as scary a world as they thought it was or have been told it was, that the reef is recovering, that the things, the messages they're getting aren't necessarily true, and that it can actually encourage them to look for more information and actually search out the truth rather than just, you know, taking what they've been told. So I think I found it really great, and I'm glad that my daughter came.
The video you just watched is for a new education platform called True Arrow Academy of Critical Thinking, or TACT for short. TACT will be an alternative education resource platform that's non-woke and non-indoctrinating, with each lesson being a potential turning point in a young learner's understanding on a range of important topics. TACT will evolve into many hundreds of animations and filmed lessons written, run, and influenced by an exceptional mix of academic heavyweights teaching against the grain, with lessons encouraging open discussion, critical thinking, and debate. TACT's duty of care is to arm and shield you against modern, subversive, mainstream education. Supporters will be the lifeblood of TACT. If you would like to support this project, let's build this together at givesendgo.com/tact. Thank you so much.